Hello, hi everybody. I am Thekla Petridou, a psychologist, YouTuber and author, and this is our weekly video in English. Today's subject is about two contrary, opposite emotions, love and fear. I was surfing on the internet the other day, trying to find some memes about love and fear, and I came up to this one which says, love is what we were born with. Fear is what we learned here. This is attributed to someone, Marianne Williamson. I'm not really sure about the attribution of words because you can find the same phrase being attributed to several people on the net. I'm just mentioning it. And this was very, very interesting to me, that people are born with love, and they learn fear on the process. Another saying I came across was one that is attributed to Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross is a world-renowned psychiatrist who studied death and the meaning of death, and it's supposed that she said there are only two emotions, love and fear. All positive emotions come from love, all negative emotions come from fear. And this was a very interesting revelation for me, because I was thinking about it. I was thinking about how fear can govern our lives and help is not such a suitable word, leads us to live fearful and unhappy lives, and how love and loving feelings can lead us to live full feeling lives and loving lives. Another interesting saying I found that is attributed to a book called A Course in Miracles. It was a very, very deep book, which I read like 15 years ago. I didn't understand all of it, but there were some valid points according to my opinion. From The Course of Miracles, it says, every choice you make is either an expression of love or an expression of fear. There is no other choice. So there are these two fundamental emotions and feelings in human beings, love and fear. And I found another, you can't see it correctly. I found another image which says, fear versus love. Fear destroys, love builds. Fear exposes, love covers. Fear screams, love whispers. Fear attacks, love protects. Fear doubts, love believes. Fear judges, love accepts. Fear wounds, love heals. So, love is what we were born with, fear is what we learned here. I am not in a position to give a valid description of what love is. We talk about love all the time. We use this word. We use it wisely sometimes, most of the time unwisely. But if I were to give a description, which I emphasize, it's not correct, it's not valid, it's just a description of love, is positive bonding and positive feelings of closeness with other people, ideas, or yourself. Loving yourself, loving other people. Love is a positive emotion. Love is what makes us smile. Love is what gives us meaning in our lives. Freud, in his psychoanalytic personality theory and in his psychoanalytic therapeutic theory paradigm, he talked about two big forces inside every human: the force of life, which can be attributed to love, and the force of death, which can be attributed to fear. All of us, all human beings, have a vast quantity of emotions within ourselves. Emotions are very, very, can be very diverse. We can feel emotions that we cannot explain what they are. And our feelings are usually the biggest riddles of our life. Why I feel like this? How do I feel? Why do I have this feeling? What do I do with this feeling? And I liked these quotes that I found online, which summarize and help people understand their feelings in two poles. Positive pole, love. Negative pole, fear. Would you like to have some coffee with me? I think that you cannot talk about love and fear without having something to drink. Preferably something stronger, but at this time of day, coffee is okay. When children are born, we are supposed to be tabula rasa in the past, that a child is born and they have no memories, they have no inscriptions on their brains, that they are just perfect. Today, we know that human infants and human embryos, to put it more wisely, are affected by their mother's psychological situation during the pregnancy and by what happens in their surroundings. We know today that from the third month of pregnancy, the baby's brain, the embryo's brain, can understand the language that the parents, the mother, or the people around the mother talk. So when a baby is born, has love within herself, but maybe also has fear. Because some mothers, during their pregnancy, they go through difficult and rough patches. They might have a difficult pregnancy. They might have some emotional issues, some marital problems, some worries, some health issues, and they might feel a lot of negative emotions. So some of the newborn babies are very calm, serene. They are smiling in their sleep. They're like little angels. And you see that they are surrounded with love and loving feelings. And some other newborns are very afraid. They have facial expressions that show fear, that show discomfort. These babies are babies that had a difficult pregnancy. Difficult pregnancies affect babies mostly, and mothers after that. I know of this because I gave birth to two children. Now I'm at the age of 45 years old. When I was 22 years old, 23 years ago, I gave birth to my son. And when I was 25 years old, 20 years ago, I gave birth to my daughter. My son's pregnancy was a very difficult pregnancy. I had problems with that pregnancy, and I had a lot of stress and a lot of fears, because before that pregnancy, there was another pregnancy that failed. So I quickly went into having another baby before recovering from the loss of the previous baby. So during the 8 months that pregnancy lasted, I was in a very bad emotional state. All the time I was worrying that maybe I will lose this baby as well, maybe the baby is not well. All the time I was going to the doctor and say, check the baby, check if he's okay, check if he's alive. And I felt my baby that he was very distressed. He was kicking in my belly and he was restless. It's not his fault. It's my fault. It's my fault that I went into pregnancy without being fully prepared for this. So when my son was born, he was a very difficult baby to handle. He was very afraid. He was afraid of the dark. He was afraid of the light. He was afraid of many things. So it was difficult for me as a mother, and for his father also, while bringing up the child. And until he came to the age of 3 or 4 years old, when he started talking fully and being able to communicate with us, it was difficult to help this child handle his difficult emotions. And also the childbirth was very excruciating. It lasted like 18 hours, and it was very painful for the baby, and the doctor had to use some equipment in order to make the delivery, because I was very stubborn. I was very young, and I had many ideas that I shouldn't have a cesarean cut. So I wanted to have a natural birth. Natural birth was very difficult to have because the baby was huge. because I had diabetes at the time, pregnancy and diabetes that I wasn't diagnosed of. Anyway, due to my misconceptions and due to my to me trying to be the perfect mother, I gave my son a difficult pregnancy and a difficult childbirth. And working with my son as a mother throughout the years, it was difficult to help him love himself, trust himself, trust other people, and be able to relax. I'm very happy now that at the age of 23, he's a very optimistic person. He has done a lot of work with himself, and he has managed to overcome the difficulties that his mother gave him during pregnancy and childbirth. On the other hand, I had a completely different experience with my daughter's pregnancy. It was a very easy pregnancy. There were no complications. I wasn't worried at all. I had other things in my mind. I wasn't worrying about the pregnancy. I was working a lot at the time. I had a toddler to deal with, my son. And most of the time, I would call the doctor and say, the baby is not kicking. The baby is not there. Something's wrong with the baby. The baby was there. The baby was healthy as a bull. She also was born at 8 months of pregnancy due to my gestational diabetes that made my babies very big, so it was difficult to have a natural birth later. So she was also born after 8 months only of pregnancy, and she was the most quiet baby I've ever seen. After her, I met other babies of other people, very quiet, but comparing my son with my daughter was very peaceful, and she was very, very loving from the beginning. She was very calm. She was smiling all the time. She was easy to connect with. This doesn't mean that she was a good person and my son was a bad person. This means that during the pregnancy, that pregnancy, I did not affect her in negative ways, and her childbirth as well was easier. It lasted only 5 hours, whereas my son's childbirth lasted 18 hours. And why I say the examples of my children's pregnancies and births, I want to emphasize that what it was written on that meme, that love is what we are born with and fear is what we learn in the process, is not so valid. Love is what we are made with and fear is what we learn in the process. And fear can be learned even in your mother's belly, even during a pregnancy, even during childbirth. You don't need to be 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years old to be taught to be afraid of people, to be afraid of feelings, to be afraid of anything. Life teaches you this. It's true. It's true that we are born out of love. What other reason is there for a new person to come to life? Other than we want to love a new person. We bring a new person to life in order to love him, love her, to give them love and expand love towards other people. Of course, I'm sure that some of you listening to this video might say, oh, I know that person who did not choose to become a parent out of love. He chose to become a parent out of bitterness or out of other negative motives. Generally, and the ideal is people to make other people, to bring other people to life out of love and in order to share the love they already have with each other, with their children, or the love they already have with themselves. Because nowadays, we have single mothers or single fathers from the beginning. We know this. It's something that new biotechnology gives us the advantage of, to have single parents from the beginning. Anyway, people are made of a loving material. Deep down in all our hearts, there is a big desire to love and be loved. Human beings feel fulfilled, feel happy when they are in loving relationships. Let me remind you of the famous Boston study or Harvard study, which concluded that it's not riches who make people happy, it's not wealth, it's not power, it's not beauty, it's not anything else, rather than deep, meaningful connections. If people have deep, meaningful connections in their lives, they feel happy. Deep, meaningful connection is another way to describe love. Deep, meaningful connection that has meaning for us and it also gives meaning to our lives. Love is what we are made of, and love is what we are destined to go to. That's what I believe. That's what I believe as a therapist, as a psychologist, and as a person, and as a human being, not just as a scientist. Because it's not very scientific to say we are made of love and we are destined to go to love, okay? This is not a scientific approach, even though the Boston study concluded that deep, meaningful connections give happiness to people. Fear enters our lives through several channels. The first primitive channel that I have already described, through our mother's or father's fears and negative emotions towards our pregnancy and our birth and our very early infancy, when we are newborns, the things we hear about, the things we listen to, the worries. It was a very interesting thing. My father, I was born in 1975, and my father used to have a tape recorder that was like a journalist tape recorder. I think he took it with him to his university classes in order to record the classes and then listen to them again. I'm not sure. So he had this idea that he should tape some times of our lives. I mean, he didn't have a video recorder in 1975, he had a tape recorder. So there was this tape going around in my house when I was young. I don't know where that tape is. I would really love to find it. I told my father about it and my mom that there are some audio tapes that I would love to have and analyze and listen to now as an adult and as a psychologist of my early childhood. I was a newborn. My father said I was 20 days old. I was crying in my parents' bedroom and my parents were talking with each other. I've listened to that tape about 30 times until the age I was 15 years old. It's been missing for the last 30 years. I think it's somewhere in the attic. I don't know where. We'll find one day. And what I remember of that tape is my mother and my father discussing calmly, talking about several subjects in a very calm manner, serious subjects. They were talking about their finances, I think. They were talking about some family members. But they did that in a very assertive voice and a very calm voice. And you can listen in the tape, the baby, me, crying. And finally, the baby stops crying. I don't know if the baby sleeps or if the baby starts listening to the conversation, but the baby stops crying. The first question I had when I was young, it was, why on earth did you allow me to cry so much time? And they told me that there was this famous pediatrician at the time who wrote books that were also translated in Greek. I don't remember the name of this guy because I hate his ideas. He was Dr. Something, a pediatrician. And he wrote some books and he suggested to parents that they shouldn't pick up their children when they were crying. They shouldn't hug their children when they were crying. They shouldn't comfort their children when they were crying. They should allow their children to cry their lungs out and learn to live by themselves. This is something that me as a psychologist and as a mother, I totally disagree with. I never did that with my son. I never did that with my daughter. But they did that with me. So at this age of 45, I still need to go to therapy to get over it. That I have learned from that technique they used as parents. I have forgiven them. I forgave them about this because they were listening to this pediatrician. They were listening to this stupid pediatrician who told the world that parents shouldn't hug their children when they were crying and parents shouldn't comfort their children because that would ruin their characters. I still need to go to therapy because I haven't learned to ask for emotional support from other people or to connect in meaningful ways with other people, because when I was young I was crying and they were kept on with their conversations. Anyway, the first school of learning fear is pregnancy, early childhood is through our parents' behavior and our parents' feelings. I said my example with that audio tape to emphasize that my parents were not giving me any negative emotions, but I had the negative emotion by myself that I was crying and nobody was comforting me. And then comes society, then comes religion, then comes education, then comes pop culture to finish us, to teach us about fear, to teach us all the social stereotypes that, for example, girls shouldn't be angry, boys shouldn't cry, that you should do this, you shouldn't do that, that you should feel guilty about that behavior and you should be doing a different behavior. I strongly believe that religion, education, and pop culture give us a lot of toxicity with fear. We learn to be afraid. We learn not to trust ourselves. We learn not to listen to our gut instinct. We learn to forget love and remember fear. This is just a very, this is just a 25-minute video, so I don't have the time. And I don't have the expertise either to explain exactly how religion puts fear in people's brains, on how education can induce fear in people, on how pop culture can also induce fear. This, I think, it's a topic that the sociologists would better analyze. But what I'm interested in as a psychologist and as a psychotherapist is that when you find people in their early adulthood or adult or middle times or even in the third or fourth age, people that are not able to enjoy love and enjoy deep, meaningful connections, enjoy loving other people and being loved by other people because they are afraid of failure, they are afraid of guilt, they are afraid of anything that religion, society, pop culture has put in their brain against love. We have learned to be afraid to be true to ourselves. We have learned not to listen to our feelings. We have learned to punish ourselves for feeling love. We have learned that love is for dreamers, love is a fantasy, and the real world is fear. I totally disagree with that view of life. Love is real. Fear is imaginary. Fear and being afraid is an emotion which is induced to us by what society says, by what religion says, by the stories of society, by the myths of religion. And why do they do that? Because they want to suppress people. They don't want people to be happy, to be free, to be powerful. They want people to be afraid so that they go and vote. They want them to be afraid so that they pay their taxes. They want them to be afraid so that they obey the rules. I'm not against the rules. I'm not against the rules, the laws. I'm not against democracy. I'm not against authority. I'm just saying that we need to distinguish between what we need to do in order to be a healthy member of a society and what we need to do in order to have a healthy emotional life. And being afraid in our private life and in our private emotional affairs destroys our opportunity for love. Why are you afraid to love? Why are you afraid to be loved? Why are you afraid to finish something which is not healthy, to finish a dead marriage, to leave a job that is no longer fulfilling you? Why are you afraid to stop a friendship that became toxic? Why are you afraid to ask for yourself what you really want? What do you really want? What do you really want? What do you really want in your life that will make you happy? I started making videos in English last June. I think it was June of 2019. And at that time, I was living in Cyprus. I was living in Nicosia, which is the capital of Cyprus. Cyprus is a very small island in the Mediterranean, which is also a state. I was presenting a daily TV show on Cypriot TV, a morning show, which was about psychology and society and matters like that. I had already written 3 or 4 books. No, no, 4 books. 4 books. 5 books. I had 4 published books and 1 book to be published at that time, last year, when I started making these videos in English. I was married with my second husband. I was married for a year and a half, around 2 years. No, for a year. I was married for a year at that time, in June of 2019, and I was very unhappy. I didn't allow myself to realize that I was unhappy. I told myself, you're happy. You're happy, you should be happy. You are on television every day. Your picture is on magazines. You are, so many people text you and love you and show their affection on YouTube, on social media. You are somewhat very famous in your small country. You have someone who lives with you and married you. You have a husband. You have 2 adult children, young adult children that are thriving in their studies. You are a writer. Your books are being successful. And so many people have good feelings for you. You should be happy. I wasn't happy. I wasn't happy. There were many reasons for me not to be happy. The main reason was that I lived in a house, in a flat, that had many negative emotions. I had connected many negative emotions with that flat. I stayed in that flat for 9 years. And some terrible things happened in that flat, in my personal life. Not something that would subject somebody to go to jail. I mean, I've had some difficulties, emotional difficulties in that house. I did not like that house. It was in the middle of the city. The view was not nice. I felt lonely in that house. I felt depressed. I was also on daily television, and I had to endure all the pressure that you endure when you work for a company. Public television is very demanding, and live television as well. And you need to compromise yourself in order to meet everybody's needs that you work for. And I also wanted to meet my audience's needs, and I also wanted to be true to myself. And I was not having any exercise. I neglected to exercise. I thought that I didn't need to exercise, but everybody needs to exercise. All my life I used to go hiking, and at that time of my life I stopped walking, I stopped hiking, and that made me somewhat depressed. And of course my marriage was not a happy marriage. But I chose to overlook that. I chose to say, let's focus on the positives in your life, Thekla. You are in your best time. You are successful. You have a very nice job. Everybody knows you. Everybody watches you on television. People love you, etc. Anyway, I started the English videos on June of 2019. On August of 2019, I took the decision to stop presenting a daily TV show. In fact, I did not sign for the renewal of my contract for a third year. I took that decision consciously because I realized that me going on that TV show every day ruined my emotions. It was a very big hardship for me. After doing that, I decided to move house. I decided to leave from the city, to leave the city and go and live in a village, because we used to rent a farmhouse in a village that was near the capital, and we went there for the weekend. So I decided to go and live permanently in that house. I did that. I felt better. A lot better. Me stopping the television show, me living in the village, made me feel better. But yet I wasn't well. I invested all my energy on growing up my YouTube channel, which had its effects, which had a good effect. On November of 2019, my new book was published. The book has the title Psychological Warfare. It's not been translated in English yet. This is something that I really wish to happen in the future. And then I had to go on a tour in Greece for many weeks in several cities and towns in Greece to tour of my book, and I was working with that, and at the same time I was working on Greek television as a guest star. Every 2 weeks I had to travel to Athens, stay in Athens for 2 or 3 days, appear, have 2 or 3 TV appears, and then come back to Cyprus. I decided on January of 2020 that I would stop appearing on Greek TV, that I don't want it anymore, because it was something that made me tired. I stopped the Greek TV. And then I was getting ready on March of 2020 to start touring again all over Greece to give some lectures and workshops and talk about my book. And then the pandemic came. The pandemic came, and in Cyprus we had a lockdown from the middle of March until the end of May 2020. During the pandemic, many things changed, and one thing that changed was the dissolution of my marriage. My marriage finished. And I found myself on June of 2020, 1 year after I started making the videos in English, trying to find who I really am and what I really want, and answering this question: what would you like to do out of love and not of fear? Because the truth is that I was afraid to divorce myself, because I don't know, I was afraid that this would sound like a failure to me or to people around me, or that I would upset my parents. I don't know, because psychologists are also people, and they also have feelings, and they also have regrets, and they also are lazy to do work with themselves. Anyway, my ex-husband took the decision for the divorce, so he helped me a lot, and I thank him again, once again, for taking that decision. So I started asking myself, what do you really want? What do you really want? And I started walking. Walking gave me back my confidence and gave me back my clear mind. Then I started working in my garden. I never worked in my garden before. I worked in my garden hard for a couple of months. This gave me a new insight in my life, a new insight, a new relationship with my body, that my body started working hard, a new connection with earth, because working in a garden and planting vegetables and stuff like that, it's a very rewarding experience. And then I decided that I will never appear on television again. And I took this decision while gardening. And I stand by that decision. I told to the TV stations that they were that gave me offers for a new TV show that I do not accept. I do not want to go on television. I started to find what I really want by excluding the things that I don't want in my life. And at this point, now today is the 2nd of October 2020, I find myself in a new country. I've moved myself in a new country where I make a new beginning. Of course, it was easy for me to do it because my job now is on the internet. I make videos online, I write my books, and I communicate with my editor online. So it's easy for me to take my microphone, my laptop, a charger, and go wherever I wish. But this point, today that I'm talking to you, on the 2nd of October 2020, finding myself in a new country where nobody knows me, where I don't have any kind of connection with the pop culture of this country, the social imperatives, the social stereotypes, the religion, or whatever this country has to do with its people, this gives me a lot of freedom. Freedom to love myself, to love the people in my life, and to have deep, meaningful connection with myself first, and with other people secondly. The reason I explained this journey of mine was to show you that at any age, at any time in your life, you always have this dilemma. Should I go with fear or should I go with love? What's the wise choice? What's the healthy choice? Fear or love? And I finished this video by emphasizing my opinion that love is real and fear is imaginary. What we are afraid of most of the time are rubbish. Most of the time, we might be afraid to, for example, I was afraid to stop my TV show. I stopped it and nothing wrong happened, only good things happened. I was afraid to move country. I moved country, nothing bad happened, only good things happened. Fear is in our brain. Fear is imaginary. Love is real. Follow your heart. Follow love. And love can only give you happiness. Remember, the Boston study, true meaningful connections. I am Thekla Petridou. Today it's Friday, the 2nd of October, 2020. If you liked my video, please share it with your friends and stay tuned because every Friday a new video in English is released on my YouTube channel. English is not my mother tongue. I wish you a lovely weekend, everybody. Bye.